They said you wanted to see me, Coach?
Yeah, man. Step on up into my office. It's Homespun Sports with Coach John Montgomery. Sports talk with a twist of down home wisdom. Welcome, 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 welcome. We are so glad you are here. Once and again, you have tuned in to Homespun Sports. It's sports talk with a twist of down home wisdom. I am your host, John Montgomery, the coach. I'm in H-Town, but way up in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, is my show-nub ride or die. What's up, Slim?
What's going on, Coach? How you doing, man?
Oh, man. It's show number 10. Time to do this thing again.
You know it. Let's do it.
Let's do it. Ladies and gentlemen, we are just so excited. As we have grown, we're going to bring on our first invited guest. Now, I got to tell you a little bit about our special guest, because special indeed he is. I'm talking about four-time All-Pro, seven-time consecutive Pro Bowl. He's in the Miami Dolphins Ring of Honor. He made the 1990 All-Decade Team. He protected Dan Marino's blind side for 10 years. My good and dear friend, Richmond Webb.
Gentlemen, how y'all doing? What's up, Coach Slim?
Richmond,
man, thanks so much for being our guest.
Coach, you know we go way back. Don't do all that, man. Come on, let's get it popping now. You know how to do it.
We go back a minute. Let me tell you. Richmond Webb from the Belt, powder That's blue it. And white.
Old Cliff is in the house. That's it.
Yes.
I got to talk briefly about a staff meeting that set the table for your greatness.
Okay.
We are in staff meeting. I'm an analyst at Texas A&M. In 1986, sitting in the staff meeting room, and head football coach Jackie Sherrill makes the announcement, we're going to move Richmond Webb to offensive line. Now, you could have heard a rat pee on drugstore cotton when Jackie said that. But Jackie Sherrill, he's the boss. So, you know, we had no idea that it was going to lead into, and I'm sure you didn't either, Richmond. But now I got to tell you, there were some heavyweights in that meeting room. R.C. Slocum was then defensive coordinator. R.C. went on to be the all-time winningest coach at Texas A&M. Bob Davey was the outside linebacker coach. He left A&M, goes to Notre Dame as Lou Holtz defensive coordinator, then gets the head job at Notre Dame. Had a secondary coach on that staff, guy by the name of Curly Hallman. Curly left A&M, goes to Southern Miss. Had a quarterback at Southern Miss, guy you might have heard of, a fellow by the name of Brett Favre.
That name sounds familiar. Yeah, I think I've heard that name.
Then Curly was successful there and went on to get the head job at LSU. Had my good and dear friend and a man I know you know well, Richmond, the wide receiver coach, guy by the name of George Pugh. And George was one of the first African-Americans to play for Coach Bryant at Alabama. There were some heavyweight guys on that staff, no question about it.
No question. I mean, that just speaks to Coach Sherrill. When you're a great coach and then you have all these assistants that go on to become head coaches and are being successful, not only you developing players, but you're developing coaches. And matter of fact, this past Wednesday, they honored Coach Cheryl here in Houston at the touchdown. That was the year. So
I was saw that there on Facebook.
That. Yeah, that was big time. So I was glad to be a part of that.
Yeah, so name guys, you know, and some of those guys, Richmond, that were at that banquet honoring Coach Cheryl, bring me back to that scout team, because Jackie said we're gonna move Richmond Webb, the offensive tackle. Well, you know, you're a pup. You go to the scout team, but what a scout team it was, Richmond. We had the center. There's a guy named Mike Arthur, who's a pup on that scout team. And I'm coaching the scout team tight ends. That was my job. And Mike Arthur played at A&M, hell of a player at A&M, had a very good career with the Cincinnati Bengals. Had a tight end that could play then. I mean, then from Italy, Texas, oh, by the way, guy by the name of Dennis Ransom.
Yes, sir. I talked to Ransom. He's like a bodybuilder now. I mean, he's always in the weight room, the gym, and all that. So as we've gotten older, he's gotten more physically fit and ripped up and all that. So he's walking around probably with a wife beat on right now.
Dennis Ransom. Hey, have hands and feet. Hello. But there were some heck of a players on that scout team. Dennis, excuse me, Richmond, thanks, man, again for coming. We want to bounce a couple of things off of you. Take it over.
Okay.
Coach, so in the preseason top, 25 poll, got the coaches poll, everybody comes out with a poll for college football. The Aggies of Texas A&M were ranked no lower than 7th. Everybody had high expectations for the Aggies coming into the season, but very disappointed. I mean, this far into the college football season, Jimbo Fisher did make good on his promise. He did say we gonna kick Alabama's ass, and he made good on that. I don't think that was enough, though. What, in your opinion, what do the Aggies have to do to get back to dominating the SEC West?
Well, I think they've made a huge leap since the Alabama game. The way I look at it, you're right. They were in the top 7 in everybody's poll before the season started, and based on the way they finished last year, had a convincing win in the Orange Bowl against North Carolina. So expectations were through the roof, and people were legitimately considering that the West, we might have an opportunity to actually win the West in the SEC West. But as the season started, two things stood out to me. I watch it in Slim, and Coach know, offensive line, I think we lost 4 starters last year. We had 4 new starters, and then we had some injuries. So the offensive line wasn't hitting on all cylinders. And then you have a new quarterback, which it takes a minute for him to get acclimated. And then the Colorado game, he breaks a leg or whatever. And then you jump to Mr. Calzada, the guy that's there now, and it took a couple of games for him to settle down. It seemed like he wasn't very comfortable in the pocket to me. I watched him. He would try to escape the pocket even when it wasn't. And when it was, he would stay when he should have ran. And when he shouldn't have ran, that's when he took off. So, but everything came together that Alabama game. And it looks like a different team. They're all focused. He's looking down the field rather than just trying to hit the little check passes to the running backs and stuff like that. Wiedemeyer, his stats and everything's going up. We get a couple of receivers back. So we've won 3 in a row. I think this is a team that everybody expected to see at the beginning of the season, but it just took them a minute to grow up. So that's my take on it.
They say it's not how you drive, it's how you arrive, Coach.
I like that. I'm about to steal that, Slam. I like that. I like that, Slam.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The next question. We're addressing the elephant in the room. You, longtime Dolphin, all-decade team from Miami. Coach, you are in the heart of Houston, Texas. Elephant in the room, like I said, the Deshaun Watson trade. He wants out of Houston. Tua can't stay healthy. They want Deshaun Watson. In your opinion, what's the take? What are they going to do?
Trade deadline right around the corner, Richmond. I know you know what's going on in Miami. I know you.
Yeah, you got to.
I'm under the belief, and this is my opinion, I don't think it's going to happen. I think this past week I heard a couple things. The owner, Mr. Ross, came out, and I think it was definitely being investigated, or it was definitely on the table, but I think he wanted some assurances that if it does happen, how much time will Deshaun, how many games will we miss this net, and with the commissioner not being able to give him a definite answer, with him being a businessman, I think he's going to push off from it. And as far as Tua being injured, with that front offensive line that they got in front of him right now, it's going to be hard for anybody to stay healthy. I mean, we give up a lot of pressures, a lot of sacks, this and that. And that's why I try to tell a lot of the fans, I think Tua is a good quarterback, but you can't evaluate a quarterback if he don't have time to sit in the pocket and do this. And even the second week of the season, that's when he got his ribs cracked. He kept getting hit. So he's back playing now, but we've got some issues to address other than quarterback. But with them not having a definitive answer on Deshaun Watson, I don't think it's going to happen. That's just my opinion.
So what you suggest is take what you got, take your capital, your picks, and build from there.
Yeah, I'm not saying they'll stick with Tua long term, but with it being so much uncertainty, it's gonna be hard for them to pull the trigger on Deshaun. But I got a couple days. We'll find out in a couple days.
Find out,
Rich.
Come on,
Rich.
Yeah, come on.
Tua Tagovailoa can't stay healthy playing two hand touch in the backyard. Now that's a fact.
Come on, man. Don't do that.
Tua Tagovailoa can't stay healthy. Now, you may not get Deshaun Watson, but y'all got to have a quarterback.
Okay.
Last thing I want to run by you, Mr. Webb. All right. The Cardinals, hottest team right now in the NFL. Coach and I's pick for the Super Bowl. A large part of their success is due to their quarterback, Kyler Murray. You are an Aggie. Everybody says, if you think Kyler's good, you should have seen his dad. How good was 1-4? How good was Kevin Murray?
And that's what we called him, 1-4, the quarterback.
Yes, sir.
1-4!
But, you know, a lot of people don't know this, but you're right. I played with his dad in college, and before I got there, Kevin had a serious ankle injury where he broke his ankle, so he became more of a pocket passer. But he's probably one of the few athletes, and I'm pretty sure about this, he made All-State in football, basketball, and baseball. He was drafted in baseball. I think he actually went and then came to A&M. So what people are seeing in Kyler Murray is his dad. He's basically his dad. He's a little shorter. His dad is bigger, but his dad was the truth. And I mean, his makeup, his mental, and everything is just like, that's his dad right there.
Richmond.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You were there. I was fortunate enough to be there for 1 year, but I can tell you this. That 1986 football team had two first-round draft picks on offense. Rod Bernstein went to the Chargers. Roger Vick, Tomball, Texas, New York Jets.
Yeah.
We had 9 of the starting 11 on defense played on Sunday. Todd Howard played on Sunday. Kip Corrington, the safety, played on Sunday. We had 9.
Johnny Holland, Larry Kim.
Come on, listen.
It's crazy.
Larry Kim, the two.
Chet Brooks. Yeah.
Hey, Rich. And thank you for bringing up Johnny Holland. Let me tell you something. Had he not hurt his neck at Green Bay, a Hall of Famer, he was just that good at Texas A&M. Johnny Holland could go. We had some players. But let me tell you one thing.
In
Richmond, you were there. If you ask the coaches, if you ask the players, ask the folks passing out the ice water on the sideline, ask the folks taping the ankles in the training room, who's the best player on Texas A&M football team? In 1986, unquestioned, the answer was 1-4, Kevin Murray.
He was the truth. He was the truth.
The gospel, let me tell you. the gospel truth. He was. He was.
No, hey, Slim, what Coach A telling you, that's the reason they moved with the offense. They were so deep on defense, I couldn't get on the field. So Jackie said, okay. Hey, put him on. Yeah, I mean, okay. we were at a point to where we would get loaded at every position. And it was almost a situation where you almost couldn't afford to get injured because the guy behind you was just as good as you, and you might not see the field again. So it was tough on defense, but they moved me over there and everything worked out. So I wasn't happy at first, but Coach knew what he was doing. So I told him thank you Wednesday when I saw him. That I don't know if it turned out if I'd have stayed on defense, but it worked out on offense. So I definitely appreciate it.
Absolutely, man. That's crazy.
Yeah. All things work together for good.
Come on, that's preach, right. Coach. Come on, give it to me.
Richmond, man, again, thank you so very much. I do appreciate it. We do appreciate it. You have blessed Homespun Sports, no question about it.
Absolutely. Hey, you guys, thanks for having me on the show. I always listen to the show, but I'm honored to be your first guest, and I'm looking forward. When y'all blow up, don't forget about me now. That's all I'm saying.
Absolutely not, man.
All right, now this on YouTube, so everybody gonna know. So y'all don't forget about me now. Don't do that.
Yes, sir.
No question. Rich,
Mr. Webb,
again, man.
Again, thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Webb. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Have a good day, sir. That was crazy, Coach.
Man, took me back a minute. Wow, I'll tell you, man, and just as great a player as he was, believe me when I tell you, even more special a human being. And now, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, without any further ado, I give to you Slim's Pickings. Take it away, Slim.
Gotcha. Gender equity took a big step in the right direction as Sonia Steeles becomes the first female commissioner of an HBCU D1AA conference, as she takes over for retiring commissioner of the MEAC, Dr. Dennis Thomas. While serving as chief of staff and chief operating officer of the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference for the past 19 years, Sonia Steeles has proven to be a mover and a shaker. Talking about negotiating contract deals with iHeartRadio, U.S. Marines, the Home Depot, even Harley Davidson. As we enter into week 10, Coach Prime's JSU Tigers sit atop of the East Conference of the SWAC with a record of 5-0. But over in the West, it's a whole nother story, as all HBCU football fans are asking the same question: is Prairie View A&M for real? Coming off an open date, the Panthers host Coach Don Hill Ely's Alabama State's Hornets for homecoming on the hill. And then it's the battle that would decide who's the best in the West, as Prairie View visits Alcorn State in week 11. Happy homecoming, PV fans. Stay tuned. And that's Slim's Pickings.
Way to go, Slim. My Panthers got to take care of business.
Most definitely, Coach. No question. Most definitely. All right, now, Major League Baseball. World Series, Pops. Our Astros are down 3-1 in the series right now. One more win, and the Commissioner's Trophy is going to Atlanta.
Yep.
All right. So, what's your take? I'm talking about since 95, Coach. It's all the way back since 95. What's your take for Game 5 tonight?
Well, it's a fact. One more win. Chop, chop. First time since 1995 the Braves won a world title. If you're Dusty Baker and every Astro fan in the country, you're certainly hoping that their flamethrower, their ace, a rookie with a year and a half experience in Major League Baseball from the Valdez, I hope he's got amnesia. That's what I'm hoping. Because he's always been able to bounce back. He had a rough outing before he faced Boston, gave them 8 innings of one-hit baseball. That's exactly what they've got to have tonight. Dusty puts the ball in his hand. Because Tuesday, he looked like hot garbage. The Braves took him to the woodshed. Now he comes back here on Sunday in game five. He's got to bounce back, have amnesia, go out there. Good location on the fastball. Good location on the changeup. He can do it. This we know. We got to get this thing back to Houston. But first, we got to win tonight.
Got no question about it. Got to, Coach. Now, college football.
Okay.
Georgia has clinched. They've clinched the SEC East when they beat Florida in the world's largest cocktail party, 34-7. That was a beatdown. Georgia's defense has more interceptions with 10 than touchdowns allowed with 6, Coach. Out of the 8 games that they have played, they've allowed 53 points. That's an average about 6.76, somewhere in there. The statement was made. Yesterday was supposed to be like statement Saturday.
Statement
Saturday. Yeah. In your opinion, Coach, who made the loudest noise?
On statement Saturday, there were several voices heard. We know now that Iowa's out. They took a beat down Wisconsin, 27-7.
They're done.
Michigan lost to Michigan State. Mel Tucker hung in.
They done.
Whipped it. Michigan's done. They got one loss, but they done.
They done.
Because you know good and hell well, they ain't going to be Ohio State. You can't trust Jim Harbaugh. It ain't happening. So for all counts and purposes, Michigan is done.
Yeah.
In the Big 12, Oklahoma beats Texas Tech. That's a yawner. Thank you, because Texas Tech couldn't beat Katy High School. So in Oklahoma sitting there 9-0 with Baylor, Iowa State, and Oklahoma State. You know, Slim, Oklahoma could win all three of them. They could also lose
all three.
They could also lose all three of them. So. But I'll tell you what you're seeing. I'll give you down the road, it shapes up to be a big time Bedlam matchup. For those of you who don't know, the Bedlam series is Oklahoma versus Oklahoma State. It's called the Bedlam game. Now, I'm an Okie, so it's called a Bedlam series. Now, it's called a rivalry, but it ain't no rivalry. A rivalry is a contest, heated.
A competitive contest, Coach.
Competitive. Thank you, Slim. It's competitive. Like Ali Frazier. That's a rivalry. They fought 3 times. Frazier won the first one. All 3 of them were competitive matchups. In the Bedlam series, Oklahoma and Oklahoma State have played 115 times. Oklahoma has won 90 of them. Oklahoma State has won 18 of them. And there have been 7 ties. Ain't no rivalry. Now, the hate is real. No question That's about fact. That. All the hate is real.
That's a fact.
Oklahoma State people hate the Sooners like the devil hate holy water. Okay? So the hate is real. But it ain't no rivalry. And it's in Stillwater this year. And the Cowboys know that Oklahoma's walking with a limp. They're limping. Okay. Mm-hmm. They know that. So, look, that shapes up to be, it's down the road a little bit, but we could have a big-time Bedlam series, and we could get 2 of them.
You get... Coach?
We could have 2 of them. So,
yeah.
So soon... Oklahoma football fans are excited about the possibility of that. No question about it. But Slim, one more thing. If you're out there on the West Coast and you're Mario Cristobal's Oregon Ducks, and you're sitting there with only 1 loss, they lost to Stanford. They got 1 loss. But you're sitting there and you're looking at them and go, excuse me, it's time out. We went to Ohio State.
The shoe, Coach. We went to the shoe.
Went, ran through them like poo-poo through a goose. Rushed for 269 yards at 7.1
per the final score of that game, Coach, was 35-28, and Oregon looked nothing like a Pac-12 team.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So you got that thrown in the mix as well. I tell you, Slim, we're going to know November the 2nd in Grapevine, Texas. The committee meets for the very first time, and that's Tuesday, just right around the corner. So we're going to know a lot more then. No question about it.
I'm excited, Coach. I'm excited. Mm-hmm. All right. Coach, the Chiefs, out of their last three games, they won two. If they're going to get back to playing that, you know, get to continue for the Super Bowl, Andy Reid has certainly got a lot of problems to deal with. In your opinion, what do the Chiefs have to do to get back to Super Bowl contending style of play?
Well, this we know. If you're gonna get there, if they make three straight Super Bowl appearances, they're gonna have to be some radical change go on with Kansas with Andy Reid's football team, because Patrick Mahomes has morphed into a turnover machine.
In his last seven games, Coach. He's thrown nine interceptions in his last seven games.
No question about it. Now they ain't beat nobody good yet. They beat Coach. They beat the Eagles. They beat the Redskins. Both of them 2-5. Okay. Exactly. They beat Cleveland
in the season opener.
And Cleveland plays Pittsburgh later on this evening. So
and they 3-4.
They 4-3.
4-3, Coach.
They're four and three. So, man, you know, Kansas City's got issues. They thought they had answered the question with the offensive line, bringing Orlando Brown over. So they've got real issues. I don't know, Slim, but I tell you what, I do know this. It's Sunday evening. We had a great show. I'm going to get out of my shirt and tie, put my feet slightly above my ass, and sit back and enjoy my Sunday evening. You do the same, my brother.
I will, Coach. Tell my mom love.
To everybody up in Oklahoma City.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Coach, tell my mom.
I will.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you guys for tuning in to this week's episode of Homespun Sports Sports Talk with a twist of Down Home Wisdom. Again, thank you so much to our special guest, Mr. Richmond Webb. We look forward to a long and prosperous, healthy relationship with you in the future, sir. Again, thank you so, so, so much. We look forward to seeing you again on the show. And hey, Coach.
Yeah, bro.
Get out of here like you came, man.
Hey, my brother, you said it again. What he said? Bang!